In my view, this argument that cholesterol levels are somehow less important than inflammatory markers raises a larger point. This is an outstanding paper on the role of inflammation in atherosclerosis. It is not appropriate to review it in a detailed way here. These researchers are well aware that inflammation is important in the process of atherogenesis. They show that our detailed understanding of atherosclerosis, enabled by genetic research, has illuminated the importance of inflammation as well as cholesterol. Two of these researchers have written separately about the inflammatory process in atherosclerosis. I just want to use their graphics to illustrate how well atherosclerosis is understood now. You can see that their description of the chain of events and its development is highly nuanced. Here's the caption for that graphic you just saw. Pause the video and read through it if you dare. I find it comical that there are CrossFit trainers and exercise physiologists out there who think they understand the development of heart disease better than today's brilliant medical researchers. Their narrative of how these plaques develop reflects our contemporary understanding. Read these few sentences and you can imagine all the research that has been done on cholesterol. We're really getting into fine-grained detail here. These people are not misguided fools, as Mark Sisson would like you to believe. Here, for example, is a recent paper that has demonstrated in new detail how dietary cholesterol creates plaques. New research into dietary cholesterol just makes it seem more and more guilty of hurting our health. This knowledge has been facilitated by the exploding use of genetically altered lab animals, particularly mice and rats. Here you see that in rodents, over 100 genes have been studied that influence the development of plaques. Notice, one of the researchers is Greg Fonrow, the author of that paper about those first-time heart attack sufferers, the one I talked about in the Playing Games with Your Heart video. Maybe he knows what he's talking about a little better than bro scientist Mark Sisson or comedian Tom Naughton. Some of this transgenic research has demonstrated how much more important cholesterol is than triglycerides in causing heart disease. Low-carb apologists often complain that experimental animal models have their limitations in helping us understand heart disease in humans. It's a bit silly to read their protest that mice, for example, were not fed proper low-carb diets, as if that makes any difference. Researchers use these experiments to methodically examine every important variable they can imagine. Do you remember when I introduced you to Anichkov, the Russian pathologist who first induced atherosclerosis in rabbits with dietary cholesterol so long ago? Even he understood that different animals processed cholesterol differently, and that they were all probably different than humans. Even our closest primate relatives do not experience heart disease the same as us. But the totality of the evidence is clear, and now that we are in the genetic age, it is even more so. Complaining that animals aren't good models for humans misses the forest for the trees. My point here is that there is a huge body of knowledge behind current fat and cholesterol guidelines. People who don't understand the science should at least understand their limitations and not attempt to contradict those who do know what they're talking about. What has all this research taught us about biomarkers? Well, total cholesterol is an excellent biomarker. But nothing has yet upstaged good old LDL bad cholesterol. The way lipoproteins work in the body is a very complicated business. Chances are the information you see on the internet is seriously oversimplified. We do need a way to measure what is happening in heart disease, and so far, the LDL score seems to tell us the most. This is because, unlike fibrinogen or CRP or any other particle that has been measured, LDL is the agent of damage to the artery. Research with saturated fats fed to transgenic mice has demonstrated this, as has research in humans. Henry Buchwald has done remarkable work to clarify the importance of LDL. Over a 25-year time frame, Dr. Buchwald has shown through surgical bypass of the ileum, a procedure that forces the elimination of LDL from the body, he was able to reduce total and heart-related deaths while not increasing the occurrence of cancer. The surgery worked because it caused the elimination of bile acids, removing cholesterol from the body. Interestingly, dogs are great at converting cholesterol into bile acids for elimination, which is why they don't get heart disease. When bile acids are retained in humans, they result in an elevation in blood cholesterol. Drugs have been used to prevent this from happening. Ileal bypass was seen as a possible alternative to drugs for lowering LDL cholesterol many years ago. Here you see Dr. Buchwald's paper from 1990 at the outset of his study. He believed his procedure would save lives because of its effect on LDL, and he was right. Here is Dr. Buchwald's paper from 2010 in which he announced his accomplishment. Congratulations to him. There is plenty of other research into LDL, of course. Here it is shown that mutations in the LDL receptor are less important than LDL levels. These mutations, of course, are what cause familial hypercholesterolemia. The lowering of LDL levels has been shown to increase plaque stability, which Lauren Cordain should like. LDL was observed to be remarkably low in vegetarians long ago. These numbers are amazing. The body needs and uses LDL, of course, but it makes all it needs without a diet that adds more. Still, LDL is not a perfect surrogate for heart disease risk. In the context of drug trials, it is now known that some drugs can lower LDL dramatically without a corresponding reduction in cardiovascular events. Nevertheless, LDL still seems to be the best way of identifying people at risk at the moment. Don't misunderstand my argument in this video. All these biomarkers give doctors valuable information that helps them determine the best treatments for their patients. All I'm saying is, don't let someone distract you with this stuff so that you can more easily rationalize eating an unhealthy diet. I think it's pretty interesting that the most important risk factor for heart disease, high LDL, is the one low-carb diets can't seem to improve unless calories get super low. What matters more than biomarkers is the risk of cardiac events. Dean Ornish has already shown that this can be improved with the help of a healthy diet. This study made him famous. Ornish was able to regress heart disease and reduce cardiac events among his study subjects, even though his diet raised their triglycerides. Should this be viewed as a failed study because their triglycerides went up? Or should this caution us about the misunderstanding of triglycerides? It shouldn't have been surprising that Ornish could do this with diet. Atherosclerosis had been turned back in animals many times. Here you see that vervet monkeys developed atherosclerosis on a diet of entirely normal Western foods. A realistic, healthier diet was able to regress these plaques a little. Ornish just used a more aggressive diet. Here, macaques responded this way as well. On the left side of both graphs, you see that atherosclerosis escalated on a high cholesterol, high saturated fat diet. To the right, you see a regression of the atherosclerosis took place when either the diet was changed to alfalfa meal or after a cholesterol-lowering drug was administered. We know now that plant foods can regress heart disease. Don't fruit and berries sound like a rather enjoyable therapy? By contrast, nutrient-poor, meat-heavy diets are associated with advancing atherosclerosis. Let's be clear that this is not health food. I've shown you that all these biomarkers may reflect reverse causation or may not be informative in some cases or are not preferable to LDL. More importantly, I have also shown you that all these biomarkers can be brought within their target ranges through a plant-based diet. Often the benefits of statins are explained away by the cholesterol deniers as the result of other effects they have beside cholesterol lowering. But doesn't it make sense that all risk factors should improve as heart disease is healed? And doesn't it also make sense to use diet to accomplish this instead of drugs? If you unwisely choose to reject what the confucianists call the conventional wisdom, which is just a weaselly way of saying the accumulated knowledge of medical science, they will not be there for you when you have a cardiac event. They want page views and sales for their products today. They won't be there to pay your medical bills or support your family when you have a serious health problem. If you require hospitalization, you will then be in the medical system, and you will be given medication that is not based on the conventional wisdom or bias, but on the real knowledge and experience of medical professionals, and they will give you targeted therapies to try to help you. You will almost certainly be put on cholesterol-lowering medication, and your quality of life will be worse, and that is if you are lucky. My advice to you, if you will consider it, is to abandon internet nonsense and take care of your health through diet while you are healthy. Whole plant foods will help you do this, and probably for less money than you spend on food right now. Don't those berries look delightful? Yet, there is a diet out there that tries to make an enemy of colorful fruits like these. It's a diet where colors are less vibrant and flavors are never naturally sweet. It's a diet that is heavy and gray. It's the gloomiest diet next in the Primitive Nutrition series.